So what if somebody has an asymmetrical infrasternal angle? Does that mean that they're half wide and half narrow? Let's talk about that. Good morning. Happy Wednesday. I have neural coffee in hand and it is perfect. All right. It's Wednesday. That means tomorrow, 6 a.m., coffee and coaches conference call. Barring any unforeseen circumstances, we will be there at 6 a.m. So please join us. The link will be on my professional Facebook page if you need that. Again, 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time for those of you playing the home game. Okay. Always tight on Wednesdays. Let's dig into the Q&A. Got a good one from Karl. Karl with a K. And Karl says, how do you train somebody with an asymmetrical ISA? Would the primary goal be to use resets to normalize, in quotes, normalize or improve symmetry first, and then train in what ranges, internal or external rotation bias, that they have available? And so I think the first question that we have to ask is, what is this representation of the asymmetrical ISA mean? And the first thing that we want to recognize that it is not half of a narrow person and half of a wide person. That would be kind of an interesting scenario, and we'd probably end up with a situation like that guy from Lady in the Water that only trained one side of his body, and so he had this big hulking like right arm and then the skinny left arm. That would be unrealistic. And so what we have to recognize is that the basic archetype, so the wide infrasternal angle archetype, the narrow infrasternal archetype, does not change when we have an asymmetrical infrasternal angle. What we're actually looking at is a management strategy as to how this person is controlling internal and external forces. So everything that we observe and everything we measure is a strategy within a context. And so under this circumstance, what we may actually have is a rate-dependent influence as to how fast some of these forces are actually being applied to the system. And so all we're seeing is a magnification of the turning strategy that this person is using to manage those forces. We would see this naturally in just about any rotational athlete at some point in time during their performance where we would see a sharper turn. We're gonna see this representation of the asymmetrical presentation through the thorax and through the pelvis. So again, this is not something unusual. And so again, we're probably looking at a change in yielding strategy. So if I magnify the overcoming strategy on one side, if I magnify the yielding strategy on the other side, I get a bigger turn. So essentially what I've done is I've moved myself further away from the dead center of middle propulsion. So I'm moving one side towards a later propulsive strategy, I'm moving the other side towards an earlier propulsive strategy. And so now what we have to say is, okay, what's the goal? Are we trying to increase the degree of adaptability? Am I trying to raise performance? And then what is the interference? And so this just becomes basic training. We have to identify, okay, what constraints are the limiting factors? How am I going to address those? And so when we talk about, well, do I need to work on symmetry first? I think the question that we first ask is symmetry even important under the circumstances? Or am I just trying to capture enough adaptability to alleviate pain? Am I trying to encourage adaptability to achieve a goal? Am I trying to raise some measure of performance? And so, like I said, it just becomes a training process. Here is presentation A, the goal is presentation B, and then I train to close the gap. So however it's necessary for me to expand the available strategies, I have to just decide. It's like, okay, do I need to just unbalance this program to achieve those goals, to become more adaptable or to raise the performance? And so then we have to just decide, okay, how much of this do I need to do? How often, my frequency, my intensities to maintain this favorable change to achieve the desired outcome. So the big takeaway here is that the principles do not change. It's just a representation, like I said, of the greater turn. So we identify the presentation just like we normally would. We determine what our intention is, what is the goal, We identify the limiting factors. These become our key performance indicators that we're going to track over time. As we train, we determine the best approach. And the way we do this is this person becomes their own experiment, just like every other person that we run a training program for, is we identify what we think we see, we intervene, and then we monitor for the changes, and we track our KPIs to determine that we're on the right process, and we're moving towards the desired goal. So just adapt the program to the individual. So it's always going to come down to those principles. They don't change no matter what our presentation is. So Karl, I hope that is helpful for you. Everybody have a terrific Wednesday. I'll see you guys tomorrow morning on the Coffee and Coaches conference call. Have a great day. Oh, if you have any questions, ask Bill Hartman at gmail.com.